Hello, good evening. I promise not to climb any ladders or break any stained glass windows tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, Eric Wetherell, what a man. An extraordinary all-round musician, orchestral French horn player, assistant musical director with the WNO Orchestra, principal conductor with the BBC Northern Ireland Orchestra, musical director of HTV, Radio 3 producer for the BBC, brilliant conductor, arranger, composer, lover of a huge range of music from Haydn to Quincy Jones, Jacob Collier, swing bands to baroque ensembles, and a huge enabler and positive friend to other musicians. Now, having Eric's tick of approval on a piece of music that you'd written was like the biggest huge gold star from your teacher. And any working collaboration with Eric was a journey of joy, wonder, and laughter, real laughter. I can't remember, we spent so much time laughing together when we were working with the Bristol Gilbert and Sullivan Society. He was born and brought up in the northeast of England, just like me, but a bit further north than me, near Newcastle. So he spent the last 40 years living in Bristol. And much of his composing was done here. Having been retired from the BBC in 1985, he filled the last 36 years of his life conducting, teaching, composing, and arranging. Bristol became his adopted city. He loved everything about the West Country in general. Now, first piece tonight, which Ben and the orchestra are going to play, was written with thoughts of Bristol's strong maritime connections. Two movements from the Bristol Quay Suite.
Thank you.
Eric loved tunes. We used to talk a lot about tunes, how important tunes were in music, and how often some composers seemed to dislike tunes or ignore them completely. We're now going to have some choral pieces. 10 years after that Bristol Quay suite, Eric turned his attention to something else that Bristol had in its background, albeit something the city quite rightly takes no pride in. But Eric loved the wonderful music that stemmed from the enslaved Africans working in the deep south of America. And that music had a profound influence on him, as on many other composers since and before. And when we've finished clearing the furniture, our local choral group, Miscellany, are going to perform two of Eric's arrangements of spirituals. So I'll hand you over to Ben and to Miscellany. We have some more choral pieces for you now. A choir made up of old companions, friends, lots of people from, I see, from Bristol GNS, who I had great pleasure, Eric and I, great pleasure working with. We're going to sing just two of Eric's choral pieces. The first, again, is a spiritual, and that's followed by one of a set of three Shakespeare sonnets that he set to music about 10 years ago. So the spiritual Weeping Mary is going to be followed by Shall I Compare Thee to a Summer's Day?
Thank you.
stunning. And hear those wonderful jazz influences in that piece, particularly. Eric wrote for so many different musical genres, everything from orchestral pieces to operas, jazz to a flute concerto, songs for children, and a recorder sonatina. So now we're going to hear a movement from the sonatina for recorder and harpsichord with Anna and Ben England. So sweet, the sound of a recorder in a building like this. Wonderful, wonderful. We Are the Women was a song cycle using seven poems written by Eric's wife, Liz, about the women left behind during World War I. The wives and the mothers, so many of whom never got to see their men again. It starts off with their feelings of pride in their young men going off to fight and ends with disillusionment. It was written when the first young British soldiers were going to war in Afghanistan, but the feelings could resonate for any war situation in history. This evening's excerpts are Pride, In My Garden, and The Mother's Lament for Her Lost Son. Hannah and Pam will sing for you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thanks, Pam and Hannah. Thank you. Miscellany have performed several of Eric's pieces, including the setting of All Things Bright and Beautiful. Now, this was sung at his funeral in March 2021. Please welcome Miscellany back to the stage. Those of us are lucky enough to know Eric were able to take advantage of his great sense of humour. He wrote the next piece, tongue-in-cheek, and gave it to Pamela Rudge, who was then head of music at the Bristol-Vic Theatre School. And I have to say, a rather wonderful head of music at the theatre school. I was claimed for years that the students who've been through her care have been rudged, because you always knew when I was coping with them, getting them to sing things, that they were so well prepped, so well taught. And here is the wonderful Pamela Rudge to say a few words about this piece. The words are by the wonderful American humorist Dorothy Parker. Pamela Rudge.
So much. Thank you, John. Please forgive my indulgence, because these words, I'm not speaking about the love song, which I'll sing to you in a minute, but I just wanted to share a story with you, because Julie Payne is playing in the orchestra later on, the Wetherell Ensemble, isn't it? Is that right? And it reminded me of something that happened with Julie Payne and Sophie Wetherell, Liz and Eric's daughter, who can't be here tonight, but I hope you're listening to this, Sophie, is all I'm saying. Sophie and I was emceeing a show in the South Pacific, and there was some lovely woodwind playing, and it's like a Morse code effect. And I was quite aware, and also there was a drummer, again, a very good friend of Eric's, Eddie Clayton, who was a great practical joker. And I was listening to, conducting away, and thinking, what they're playing isn't actually accurate. But it's fine, because it sounds quite authentic, actually. And it wasn't until the end of the week that I discovered that Eddie had brought in a Morse code book. And over the airways, they were, I won't repeat, actually, what they told me they played. But it was quite derogatory. But anyway, I thought I'd share that. And Sophie, that was for you. Okay, honey? Thank you very much.
Be a little session of musical chairs now while the orchestra come back on, I think. We're talking before about Eric's wonderful sense of humour, and And yeah, one of the things, jokes he used to tell me that his father had told him many years before is, but bear in mind, they're from Newcastle, the Geordies, and this village has actually been in the news recently. It's a village called Harden, which is up in the Durham mining area. It's a very impoverished area at the moment. But the story goes that a little old lady was getting off the local train and needed a lift. And in those days, we're talking about late 19th century, early 20th century, no diesel taxis, but a horse and cart. So she gets in the back of the cart, and the driver, they're trotting away, and the driver says, "Are you for Harden, miss?" She says, "Well, no, it must be the horse." That was one of Eric's gags, and well, he's one of Eric's father's gags, let's put it that way. But I love it. So I always said he was a chipper little Geordie, actually. This major musical chairs. I feel we should have a sort of musical moment while this is going on. How are we doing, guys? It'll be worth the wait. I know it will be worth the wait. Yep, yep. We're very privileged to have with us tonight the wonderful Chris Gradwell, who's the founder of the London Saxophone Quartet and has come all this way to play a movement of Eric's concerto for alto, sax, and strings. Again, it shows Eric's love of jazz. Are we nearly there? Yes, of course. Thanks, Ben. And welcome Chris Gradwell, please.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Extraordinary. Interval is coming up. During the interval, wine and soft drinks will be available. It's not a cash bar, but we would be grateful if you make a donation for your drink. But before that, could I introduce, please, Mr. Frank Noble, CEO of St. Peter's Hospice, to say just a few words.
Thank you so much. Wow, what an evening. I never met Eric, but it's an immense privilege to be here in amongst such amazing music. I'm Frank, the CEO up at St. Peter's, and it's wonderful to be here celebrating the life of Eric and reflecting on the small contribution that St. Peter's Hospice made to Eric's life. I actually feel a strange personal connection with Eric, someone I've never met. Because in 1976, Eric was the principal conductor of the BBC Northern Ireland Orchestra. And I'm told by Liz that he never allowed the troubles that were emerging at that time to stop the music. Well, some 17 years later, I arrived in Belfast as a young officer when the troubles were still quite troubling. A few years later, I returned a little older and wiser as the commander of the Engineer Regiment, and thankfully, praise be, the politicians finally got their act together and signed that historic peace deal. And I was then put in charge of the 15-month program to remove all of the infrastructure. And in 15 months, we took down all of the hilltop sites, all of the observation towers, all of the border crossing points. And I was reflecting earlier that, wow, Eric was there conducting in 1976 when it all began, and I was there when it ended. It's an equal privilege to be part of the St. Peter's Hospice team. We pride ourselves in looking after the whole patient. We look after the clinical needs of the patient, as well as the emotional, psychological, spiritual needs of the patient. But we also look after the families, and we look after their friends, and we look after their loved ones and their carers. But there's a fact that I'd love you to take away with you, because I suspect not many of you know it. I certainly didn't know it when I started. And that is that we look after about 3,000 people a year, and 90% of them never come anywhere near the hospice. We come to them. 90% of our patients are looked after at home. Our nursing teams, our hospice at home, our spiritual counselors, our emotional psychological guys, our social workers, and on it goes. 90% of the folk we look after in their home. But of course, we also have an amazing inpatient unit at Brentry. It was finished in 2018, and thank goodness it was, because when the pandemic started, we were able to continue with visiting all the way through, because every room has an outside access. It costs us £24,000 a day to run the hospice. That's just the clinical teams. £24,000 each and every day, whether there's a pandemic or a cost of living crisis, we have to find that money. And it's events like this that allow us to do that. We've been going for 45 years serving Bristol, and thanks to your support tonight, this contribution will hopefully help us to keep going for another 45 years. So Liz, family, thank you very much. Really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, if we could take our seats for the second half. Thank you very much. Thank you so much, everybody. If I could invite you to take your seats for the second half of the performance. And it is my very, very great pleasure to introduce something a bit different, something very special. I'm not sure if you're aware, but a couple of years ago, there was this virus going around. Might have heard about it, it was on the news a bit. And in all seriousness, in March 2020, when it became clear that choirs were the kind of thing that were going to spread the virus rather than the usual love and community and fun that they usually do, it was a devastating time for those of us who love making music and singing. And I rang Eric, who was at that time not very well and had told me that he'd given up composing at this point. But I rang him and I said, would you mind if I put on some online performances of your music? And he said, use whichever pieces you like, which was incredibly kind and generous of him. And I chose for the first of many performances that I put together online with musicians from all over the world playing in their houses. I chose his arrangement of the Ulster air, My Lag and Love, which I'd previously done with several choirs, and I knew how warm it was and how much joy it brought people. And I had a sneaky idea. I reached out to Miscellany, who entertained us so beautifully in the first half, and I also reached out to Eric and Liz's daughter, Sophie, who I knew was stuck in Dubai, not able to come home and see her parents, and I asked them to record this wonderful piece. And I then had a message from dear John Kay from the BBC, who said he was interested in putting this out, and it went out on the Today programme, ladies and gentlemen, at the end of March of 2020, which was a wonderful, wonderful thing to do. Now, what we're going to see is sort of the next step on from that, because I then went on to form two online choirs, one that did Handel's Messiah in lockdown, and the other is a group called Home Choir, many of whom are watching live at the moment via the magic of YouTube and live streaming. And hello to all the home choristers watching in America, Canada, Australia, Singapore, Japan, many, many of them. I asked them to record this special version of My Lag and Love. My dear friend Nikki, who's watching in Northern Ireland at the moment, made the video that you're about to see. And we've blended the performance we recorded in March 2020 with hundreds of voices from all around the world, and we'd love to show it to you now. So can you put your hands together for Home Choir, ladies and gentlemen?
Thank you.
just going to move the screen now. So while they're doing that, let's have a few words about Eric at the Royal Opera House and the Welsh National Opera. It's one of the stories Eric, was one of the things Eric said to me when I was some years ago with the Bristol Choral Society. We were singing Michael Tippett's Child of Our Time at the Proms. And I was chatting to Eric during one of our rehearsals and saying, do you know, the spirituals are wonderful, but, you know, some of Tippett's music is ghastly. It's just unsingable, you know. And he said, oh, yes. He said, well, I remember. I remember when I was at the Welsh National. He said, I was teaching them the dots for King Priam. He said, the first production of King Priam. And he said, I thought at the time, he said, well, I could teach them any notes. It wouldn't make any bloody difference. And Eric's wonderful. I tell you, Eric loves tunes. You have tunes. So anyway, when Eric got to the age of 85, he decided it was time to write his own opera. He discovered a book by Ben McIntyre. Some of you might be watching Rogue Heroes, the SAS thing at the moment. That's another Ben McIntyre book, adapted book. He discovered the book by Ben McIntyre, A Foreign Field. And he thought it was a fantastic story. And he persuaded Liz, his wife, to write the libretto, persuaded friends, orchestral and vocal, to perform it, and set to work to rehearse and then run the piece for four performances. We staged it in 2010. I was very honored that Eric asked me to direct it. And we had an absolute ball. Wonderful design by James Helps. Fantastic singers and wonderful music. We staged it again in 2018 when Ben musical directed it, and Eric was in the audience at that point because Eric had conducted the first outing. And it's a story. It tells a story of British soldiers caught behind fluid enemy lines in France during the First World War. The lines were very fluid at this point, and sometimes it was English territory, sometimes it was French. And they got suddenly overrun by the German line, and they got caught behind. And one of them, Robert Digby, falls in love with the village girl. He's billeted, secretly, three soldiers billeted with this family. And the girl falls pregnant and has his baby. And it was that baby, that Ben McIntyre met as an old woman when he went to see the ruins of this French village back in whenever it was, 1990 something. And she said, I was that baby. Robert Digby was my father. Absolutely amazing. The village commandant was utterly ruthless and utterly mad, and demanded that the French gave over all of the blackberries. He noted how many blackberries on the bushes and things like that. He actually demanded that, it was absolutely true, that the soldiers could have all the eggs laid by the hens, but every cockerel in the village had to lay an egg specially for him. funny, but he was also completely ruthless. The soldiers were eventually betrayed by probably a jealous villager. And they gave themselves up on the understanding that they and the villagers would not be harmed, but this man ensured that they were shot, and the village was completely razed to the ground. So that's the story that Eric and Liz set so wonderfully. Charlie Morris, Hannah Long, and Pamela Rudge will give us some short extracts from A Foreign Field. Thank you.
Thank you.
That brings back many happy memories. The Snow Child was Eric's second opera, which he wrote in 2014 at the age of 89. It was based on a book by the Alaskan author Johan Ivey, and the original story was taken from an old Russian folk tale. The songs here are sung by Faina, the Snow Child, and the young Alaskan country boy she falls in love with. Marjory Walker and Samir Savant perform these roles, and the orchestra plays a short, gentle scene d'amour in the middle.
Thank you.
brings back for me such wonderful memories. Dear Eric feels very close at those moments. That wonderful cello tune in the orchestral section there. And that little motif that you hear in fourths on the piano there, and also in part of the orchestral section, was actually played originally on the orchestra. We had a harp in the orchestra, and that was one of the, it played an ostinato and on consecutive fourths. And Eric told me that he devised that because he was very inspired by Miles Davis, the great jazz musician Miles Davis, who often used consecutive fourths or fourths one on top of another, instead of using a as we have in a normal triad, sort of fifth and a third in the middle, he'd have a fourth, so a C going to an F, two into a B flat. And Eric found that very intriguing and used that as the harp ostinato for Snow Child. It's just amazing to me how, listening to that again, because I haven't heard this, well, since we did it, and to feel Eric's voice so close, right there. Now, you saw earlier Lagan Love, done by Ben's choir. And as he said, it was broadcast on the Today program. Eric was so delighted that he wrote an orchestral version for Ben as a gift to say thank you. And so we're now going to hear Eric's orchestral version of Lagan Love. Thank you, Ben.
Start composing again. The summer of 2020, the piece you're about to hear is the result of that work. And
Our final piece tonight is a portrait of the city, written very much with Bristol in mind. It was originally written for wind band, but in 2020, Eric decided to rearrange it for full orchestra. And he was still working on it in October 2020, just 3 months short of his 95th birthday. But then he felt too tired to complete it. But his good friend, Will Todd, finished the final movement. Tonight is the very first performance of the orchestral version, Portrait of a City.
Thank you.
Those of us that knew Eric knew that he had a wicked sense of humour. And just before the last night, in fact, the second half of the last night of a show, he would make his way into the orchestral pit and sit on his stool, and he would say very clearly to the orchestra, "One final spasm, ladies and gentlemen." And as this is the last thing, I'd like you to say with me, after three, "One final spasm, ladies and gentlemen," to honour the man who has brought us this incredible evening of music. And I know he would love it if we did this. One, two, three.
One final spasm, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you very much indeed. Here we go. Thank you. to say a couple of words to wrap up this extraordinary evening. I would like to thank every one of the musicians behind me. No one is taking a fee for this concert. We are all doing this in aid of the hospice. If you have found tonight to be as stirring, as moving, as magical as we have, please do give generously at the buckets on the way out. And those of you watching on YouTube, please also donate via the link. Obviously, everyone has done an amazing job today, huge amount of rehearsal. Can we also thank John Telfer and Miscellany and everyone who's taken part tonight? Thank you, everyone. And I would like to say a huge thank you to Eric Wetherell, whose music has inspired me and so many other people, not just behind me, but throughout this city, throughout this nation. His music is extraordinary. I'm sure you'll agree after tonight. So can we give Eric a huge round of applause? Yeah. That Liz would like to say a couple of words. So, Liz, are you around?
She's behind you.
She's behind me. Are you going to ascend? Oh, I think you should ascend. Can we make room for Liz, please, everyone?
No, I'll stay here.
No, we need you to to hear you.
Oh, no, I'll never get
ascend. Oh.
If I say this really loudly, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Thank heavens, I do not want to go.
Oh, go on, Liz, go on. Can we just pull the stands to one side?
I'm so sorry.
Just ascend, Liz.
2 minutes.
Oh.
I bet you thought I'd never get up here. I won't be long. I'm sure you are longing to get home. It was a wonderful, delicious, fantastic, well, unbelievable concert. Eric would have loved it and disliked it in equal measure. I say disliked only because he was a modest character and he never felt that his music deserved what it got tonight. On behalf of my family, I really have to say some thank yous. Ben has already done it, so he's pipped me at the post a little bit. Nonetheless, the orchestras, choirs, soloists, backstage team, church officers, St. Peter's Hospice volunteers, and thank you also to you, the audience. Hugely important characters in a musician's life. Fantastic wizardry also from Martin Harris and the UE technical team, sorting out all the sound, microphones, thank you, and the bit at the back as well where you saw the home choir. But we also had a backstage team who worked extremely hard putting this on. People who worked out the financial side of things. There was a small team who I can't thank people individually. They know who they are, and I am most, most grateful to them. The design of the programs, the interval drinks, and you will notice, or you may notice, that the person responsible for the interval drinks was also one of our soloists here tonight. So everybody had a dual role. Hannah, another of our soloists, looked after the business side of things. I'm hugely grateful to all of them. I won't take too much more of your time, but in March last year, when Eric died, the funeral was of necessity a small one, 30 people in lockdown. He would have loved it. Just his scene. No fuss, but people who loved him, his family and close friends. And that to him would have been great. But Ben at the time said, we're not having that. We have to do more. So 20 months later, it was rather a long gestation period thanks to COVID, but nevertheless, the concert was born, and here it is tonight. And I have to say that without Ben, this wouldn't have happened. He has been the most extraordinary person behind all this, and I'm lost for words in terms of how many bits of thank yous I can say to him. But Ben, you're an absolute star. I know what you felt about Eric, but he was also so fond of you and saw you as a particularly inspiring musician, and somebody who obviously said lots of funny things as well and made the audience respond. Many thanks to all of you. I know you're dying to get home now. I haven't had a chance to talk to some people during the interval because the interval is always a bit shorter than you would like it to be in some respects. So some of us are going next door to Doubletree Hilton to have a drink, a post-concert drink. Please do join us if you want to have a further chat. It would be lovely to see you. But on your way out, don't forget to drop those bits of paper into the bucket for St. Peter's. It was a charity very close to Eric's heart. We will always love him and miss him and think very fondly of him. He was a very special person. Thank you.